The next morning, I had breakfast in the cafe with Adam, and he seemed preoccupied as I ate my scrambled eggs and bacon, and he poked at his French toast. "Bill," I said, "what's wrong?" "I'm worried." "What about?" We were seated in a rough wood booth and had plenty of privacy. We kept our voices down. Our conversation, after all, wasn't really proper breakfast conversation. "I don't think you should hit him like that." "Like what?" He frowned, on his way back to his cabin after the bar closes. "Oh, why?" "He might not be drunk enough. Bar closes early Sunday night, remember?" "Jesus," I said, "the fucker starts drinking at noon. What more do you want?" "But there could be people around." "At midnight? It's a resort. People get romantic at resorts. Moonlight strolls." "You got a better idea?" He nodded. "Do it in his room. Take the wife's jewels, and it's a robbery got out of hand, in and out, no fuss, no muss."
"Are you high? What about the wife?"
"She won't be there."
"What are you talking about?"
He started gesturing earnestly. "She gets worried about him, see? It's midnight, and she goes looking for him. While she's gone, he gets back, flops on the bed, you come in, bang, bang, boom." I just looked at him. "Are you psychic now?"
"How do you know she'll do that?"
He swallowed, took a nibble at a forkful of syrup-dripping French toast, smiled kind of nervously. "She told me so," he said. We were walking now. The sun was filtering through the trees and birds were chirping and the sounds of children laughing wafted through the air.
"Are you fucking nuts, making contact with the client?"
"Quarry, she contacted me, I swear."
"Then she's fucking nuts. Jesus!"
I sat on a bench by a flower bed. "It's off. I'm calling the broker. It's over."
"Listen to me, listen. She was waiting for me at my cabin last night. After we struck out with the college girls, she was fucking waiting for me. She told me she knew who I was."
"How did she know that?"
"She said she saw me watching them. She figured it out. She guessed.
And of course, you confirmed her suspicions."
He swallowed.
"Yeah."
"You dumbass dickhead. Who said it first? Who said what first? Who mentioned killing? Who mentioned murder?"
His cheek twitched.
"Well, me, I guess. She kept saying she knew why I was here. Then she said, 'I'm why you're here. I hired you.' And you copped to it? God, I'm on the next bus. Quarry, listen. This is better this way. This is much better."
"What did she do, fuck you?"
He blanched, looked at his feet. "Oh, God," I said. "You did get lucky last night. Fuck, you fucked the client. Did you tell her there were two of us?"
"No."
"She's seen us together. I told her you're just a guy I latched onto here to look less conspicuous."
"Did she buy it?"
"Why shouldn't she? I say we scrap Plan A and move to Plan B. It's better."
"Plan B being, Quarry, she's going to leave the door unlocked. She'll wait for him to get back from the bar, and when he's asleep, she'll unlock the door, go out and pretend to be looking for him, and come back and find him dead and her jewels gone. Help, police, I have been robbed. My husband's been shot. You know."
"She's being pretty fucking helpful, you ask me."
His face clenched like a fist. "The bastard has beat her for years, and he's got a girlfriend a third his age. He's been threatening to divorce her, and since they signed a premarital agreement, she gets jack shit if they divorce, the bastard."
"Quite a sob story."
"I told you we're doing the world a favor, and now she's doing us one. Why shoot him right out in the open when we can walk in his room and do it? You gotta stick this out, Quarry. Shit, man, it's $5,000 apiece and change."
I thought about it. "Quarry?" I'd been thinking a long time.
"Okay," I said. "Give her the high sign. We'll do it her way." The Bar W Bar was a cozy, rustic room, decorated with framed photos of movie cowboys from Ken Maynard to John Wayne, from Audie Murphy to the man with no name. On a brown mock leather stool up at the bar, Baxter Benedict sat, a thin, handsome drunk in a pale blue polyester sport coat and pale yellow Banlon sport shirt, gulping martinis and telling anyone who'd listen his sad story. I didn't sit near enough to be part of the conversation, but I could hear him. "Milking me fucking dry," he was saying. "You'd think with 16 goddamn locations I'd be sitting pretty. I was the first guy in the Chicago area to offer a paint job under $30, $29.95. That's a good fucking deal, isn't it?"
The bartender, a young fellow in a buckskin vest polishing a glass, nodded sympathetically.
Not his competition killing me. What the fuck kind of paint job can you get for $19.99? Will you answer me that one? And now that bitch has the nerve. Now he was muttering. The bartender began to move away, but Baxter started in again. She wants me to sell. My life's work. Started from nothing. And she wants me to sell. Pitiful fucking money they offered. Pitiful.
Last call, Mr. Benedict, the bartender said. Then he repeated it louder without the Mr. Benedict. The place was only moderately busy, a few couples, solitary drinker or two. The wistful wagon lodge had emptied out largely this afternoon. Even Betty and Veronica were gone. Sunday. People had to go to work tomorrow, except, of course, for those who owned their own businesses, like Baxter here, or had unusual professions, like mine. I waited until the slender figure had stumbled halfway home before I approached him. No one was around. The nearest cabin was dark.
Mr. Benedict? I said.
Yeah, he turned, trying to focus his bleary eyes.
I couldn't help but hear what you said. I think I have a solution for your problems.
Yeah, he grinned. And what the hell would that be?
He walked on the unsteadiest of legs up to me. I showed him the 9mm with its bulky sound suppressor. It probably looked like a ray gun to him.
Fuck, what is this, a fucking holdup?
Yes, keep your voice down, or it'll turn into a fucking homicide. Got me? That turned him sober.
Gotcha. What do you want?
What do you think? Your watch and your rings.
He smirked disgustedly and removed them, handed them over.
Now your sport coat.
My what? Your sport coat. I just can't get enough polyester.
He snorted a laugh. You're out of your gourd, pal. He slipped off the sport coat and handed it out toward me with two fingers. He was weaving a little, smirking drunkenly. I took the coat with my left hand, and the silenced 9mm went thup, thup, thup. Three small, brilliant blossoms of red appeared on his light yellow banlon. He was dead before he had time to think about it. I dragged his body behind a clump of trees and left him there, his worries behind him.